Hello friends, in the previous lecture we have got to know that is what is octet rule, and based on that we have also made an arrangement that how can we form a bond or how many bonds that have been formed because of the octet rule. But we have also discussed about the inadequacies of the octet rule, and that also we have got to know that there are also certain kind of the molecules that form the bond between the other molecules even though they are not following the octet rule. So now we are going to talk about the bond parameters, and bond parameters plays a very vital role in understanding that how much stronger is the bond, or what is the interaction between the particular atom with that of the other atom so as to form a bond. So these are basically known as the bond parameters that we are going to talk about. So let us talk about it. So now we are going to talk about the bond parameters, and the bond parameters are basically bond energy, bond length, bond angle and bond order. So let us understand each of it one by one, and with the help of an example also we could understand it in a very nice way. So let us talk about the first one, that is bond parameter, that is the bond enthalpy or bond energy we could say. So what is actually bond enthalpy? So bond enthalpy is basically defined as the amount of energy required to break one mole of the bond between two atoms in a gaseous state. For example, if I'm talking about like that of hydrogen, so hydrogen, suppose if it is in gaseous state, but this is a molecule, but we want the dissociation, or we need to break this bond. So now while breaking this bond, we could see that the hydrogen, which is of a gaseous state, now this has been turning into an atomic form. So the hydrogen molecule is now been turning into a hydrogen atom, and this is how the energy that has been required. We need the energy so as to convert this molecule into its respective atoms, and that is the reason that this indicates that what would be the strength of the bond, and that is basically known as bond energy. Because if we break this bond, then only it will be able to give us the atomic form of the hydrogen, and the energy that has been required to break this bond has been found to be that of we usually represent it with delta H. So delta H of atomization, and I have represented here as A, and this A means we have converted basically the molecule into its atom, and the energy that was being required in this case is basically 435.8 kilojoule per mole, and that is what we have discussed about the definition also, that is the energy required to break one mole of bond. So here it was only one bond that we have got out over here, and that's the reason that the bond the energy required to break the bond is basically 435.8, but this is for the hydrogen, it is not valid for everyone, because a particular molecule have a kind of the bond strength that is attached between the two atoms, and the two atoms can be same also, can be different also. So it depends on basically the atoms that are forming the bond. So similarly, I could take an example of like this one, that is the oxygen. So this is a gaseous oxygen and a gaseous molecule, and for which we have to convert into atom while breaking the bond. So suppose if we have provided particular energy, and then only it will give us a particular atom of oxygen. So this is what it is. But the energy required to break the bond, because we are not trying to break one bond, we are breaking the all kind of bonds that are between the two atoms, and that energy is basically here, I'm going to represent it as delta H of A, and this is basically, it is found to be 498 kilojoule per mole. So this much amount of energy has been required to break the bonds, and that is basically the bond energy, or we could call it as bond enthalpy. So this is what I want to talk about. So now in this case, basically the two atoms that were been forming a bond, they were similar. While here also they were similar, but what if we are saying that if the two atoms that are been forming the bond, if the two atoms are of different, so if the two atoms are different, then it will depend on the electronegativity and various factors that will change the enthalpy, bond enthalpy, and that is what we are going to discuss in the later one also. So talking about the next one, that is when it comes to the carbon-carbon single bond, carbon-carbon triple bond and carbon-carbon double bond. So in this case, suppose if the thing is that I want to express is, the energy required to break this bond is very less compared to that of this one and this one. it's not only because of the number of bonds, but it is also because of the length of the bond. And the more the bigger length, then it was very much easy to break that bond. And that is the reason that for the carbon cover single bond, that the energy required to break the bond is basically, I'm representing by delta HA, and that has been found to be, that is 348.4 kilojoules. And that of carbon-carbon double bond, the energy required to break this bond, it was found to be 614.7, while that of the delta H for breaking the bond between carbon-carbon triple bond, it is found to be, that is 840, and all has a unit of kilojoule per mole. So as you could see that there was carbon-carbon single bond, so and carbon-carbon double bond over here. So it is not exactly the double of the energy required to break carbon-carbon double bond. Obviously, here the interaction also plays a very vital role, and that's the reason that the less amount of energy has been required here, and double that of that is 348.4. And here also we could see that less than the double is been required to break this one, and that is, it depends on the interaction. So that is what I wanted to explain, that this carbon-carbon single bond that we have break over here, that is not similar to that of what we have break over here for hydrogen and hydrogen. So it depends on the it depends on the atom which are making the molecules. So similarly, the thing, all the examples that I have took over here, it were having the same kind of atoms that were attached to each other. And what if I have made an example which showcase that the hetero atoms, they are forming basically like this one. So suppose if this water molecule is basically present in a gaseous state, and for which it is, we have to break the bond. So the first bond that I could break is basically the bond between the hydrogen and OH. So therefore, it will convert into hydrogen gas atom, while that of, not hydrogen gas, I would say, a atomic form of hydrogen that will be in a gaseous state, and that of the OH, this group also will be in a gaseous state. But the bond energy, or the energy required to break the bond between this hydrogen and this oxygen, it is found to be that is, the delta H, it was found to be that was 402 kilojoule per mole, while that of this is, one is remaining, and the bond is not been broken yet. So again, if I take the example over here, and this is OH, and which is present in a gaseous state, and for which again I break the bond between this O and this H, so it will convert into H, which is gaseous state, and the oxygen also, which is of the gaseous state, and the H, the delta H, or the enthalpy, that is, or the heat required to break the bond, it has been found to be 427 kilojoule per mole. So if you observe this two, that is, this one was the hydrogen and this one was the oxygen. So the bond, the energy required to break the bond, the energy required to break the bond is suppose 502. So why doesn't this oxygen and this hydrogen bond that it has, it requires exactly 502? It should be 502, but it is not 502. It is basically 427 kilojoule per mole, and obviously it is less or something different. So the reason behind that is interaction. Yes, now this hydrogen is being accompanied by that of OH, and that's the reason that the energy required to break the bond here, it will be more. But that of this is the only oxygen and only hydrogen that it has, and that's the reason the bond energy required for this to break, it is comparatively less, or somewhere we could say it is different. So that is what I wanted to explain about the bond energy, and it depends on molecule to molecule or atom to atom or any kind of interaction. So that is what the nature of chemical bond is. So this was the first parameter that I was trying to talk about, and let us talk about the further part. And so this is the bond energy that we have discussed over here, and now let us talk about the next one, that is, so now let us talk about, that is, what is bond length. Actually, this is the next parameter that we are going to talk about, and talk about this one. So the bond length is defined as the equilibrium distance between the nucleus of the two bonded atoms in a molecule. So basically, it is the distance between the two nucleus, that is, of the atoms that are forming a bond, and that is the reason that it is being called as bond length. So let me give you an example of this one. So this is the thing that we have discussed earlier also, that is, when I am talking about the examples like that of the carbon-carbon single bond. Now here it is carbon-carbon double bond, and this is carbon-carbon triple bond. So just for in case, suppose if I'm trying to give the atomic radius for this one, then, or the bond length between this all three, then it has been found that carbon-carbon single bond is the one which have larger length, while the while talking about the next one, that is carbon-carbon double bond, it will have a that is smaller length compared to that of the carbon-carbon single bond, and the carbon-carbon triple bond will have the least length between the carbon and carbon because it is forming a triple bond, and that is the reason that the interaction of this is more compared to that of this one and this one. So making this to have basically more energy is required so as to break the bond over here, and or to completely break the bond between this carbon and this carbon, less energy is required and much more least energy is required to break this bond. So this is another thing that I have talked about, the energy, and now I'm talking about the bond length. So for that I have an example just as to showcase that is what is actually covalent, because these are the things that have been forming covalent bond, and that is the thing that I want to talk about. So this is a short diagram that I want to explain about, and suppose I'm talking about this one. So suppose these are the two different atoms that I am representing over here. So therefore there will be a nucleus that would be attached, that would be for this red one, while there will be a nucleus of this one. So therefore this is the bond length, as I could say. But these two atoms are being different, so individually we can calculate that what would be the covalent radius for this. And suppose if I want to take the radius of a particular atom, so I could easily take the radius, and that would be basically the difference between these two. So therefore this is basically the covalent radius, or I am represented by RC. Here also I could say that they will have a particular covalent radius, because covalent radius is nothing but the radius of a particular atom that has been forming the covalent bond, and it is very much easy to calculate that one, because it would be the half or sometimes suppose if this both two are of the same atom, and then this would be very similar, that we could easily calculate that what we have to do is we have to identify what would be the bond length, and we have to divide it by 2, and then we will get easily to know that what is the radius of the atom. But suppose if these two are different, so we have to individually calculate that what would be the covalent radius of a particular atom and that of the other atom. So this is the covalent radius that I have expressed, and that has been noted by RC. So from that also we can easily estimate that what would be the bond length for that. But the new term that I am going to talk about is in this case is that is van der Waal radius. So van der Waal radius are basically even it is very much similar to that of the covalent radius that we have calculated, but there is a difference. Suppose if these two are forming one molecule, while this two is also forming one molecule, but if you could see that there is similar atoms that are being attached in this case, and this is the covalent radius. This is the range which will have basically non-bonded electrons, and that's the reason that they are forming solid over here. And because we already know that's what is van der Waals force of attraction. So in this case, suppose if this is how the two molecules they attached with each other, but since these two are the similar atoms, so therefore we could easily estimate that what would be the covalent that is van der Waal radius, that is this one. So therefore the thing that we have to do is we have to take the radius of this one, and we have to take the half of this, and this is how we can estimate the van der Waal radius, and that is, so van der Waal radius is comparatively more than that of the covalent radius, and this is how we can calculate for different kind of molecules. So usually for defining a bond length, we take the covalent radius, and with the help of that we can estimate that what is the bond length. And usually bond length is basically have a unit of picometer or angstrom. Obviously the bond distance is very much less, and this is how we can express it. So this was something which was related to the bond length, and now let us move on to the next one, that is what is bond angle. So this is the one that I'm going to express, that is what is bond angle. Again, it is the third parameter of the bond parameter that we know. And what is this? So let us understand it. That is, bond angle is definite angle exist between the two covalent bonds present in the molecule. It is nothing but it is a very simple thing that I want to express, suppose like that of H2O. So H2O has this kind of shape, it is never linear, but it will have a shape, and these are the two covalent bonds as you could see over here. So therefore this would be a definite angle, so this is the angle that will make to form the bonds over here, as you could see. So this is the molecule that it has, and these are the two covalent bonds, and between this we can estimate the angle, and it has been found that the angle between or the bond angle of the water, it has been found to be 104 degrees 35 minutes. So that is the bond angle between the of water. And talking about the next one, that is for methane. Since it is the one which is forming a tetrahedral bond, sorry, tetrahedral geometry, so for the bond angle that is between these two covalent bond is basically 109 degrees 20 minutes. So that is what the bond angle is. So for every molecule that has a particular bond angle, and we could estimate it very easily with the help of X-ray crystallography, and there are various methods to determine what is the bond length. And let's talk about the next one. That is bond order. So what is bond order? Bond order, actually it is the last parameter that we are going to talk about. So bond order is given by the number of bonds between the two atoms in a molecule. It is very simple to calculate. For example, if I am talking about the nitrogen, so to form a nitrogen, we see two bonds, three bonds are being combined so as to form nitrogen molecule. So that's the reason that the bond order is three. Talking about oxygen, it is two. Hydrogen, it is one. But talking about H2O, suppose, so we have to specify that bond order between which and which atom we are talking about. Like oxygen and oxygen, that is one. So for example, for a carboxylic acid, the bond order between the oxygen and carbon, whether this or this, that is the main thing. So between these two, it is basically the bond order is 2, and between this, it is bond order is 1. So that is what the bond order is, and that is what the bond parameters that I was wanted to talk about. So that is, friend, that is what I want to talk about, and thank you, friends, for watching this video. I hope you have understood this video very clearly, and you have got to know the various bond parameters. And I hope you will share this video with the friends, and just don't forget to subscribe to the channel. Thank you so much.